Good morning, everybody, and welcome to another class of online catechism. So presently we are at lesson number 12, as you can see in the slide over here, apostolate through priestly life. Now in this particular lesson we are going to talk about how priestly life is important for the benefit of the society and the Christian community. This also gives us an opportunity to think about the priests in the Old Testament and in the New Testaments before Jesus came and then after Jesus came, and then how our priests are now. So an understanding about their difference is also very important to the apostolic or the ministerial activities of our Catholic mission. So as an introduction, the letter to the Hebrews speaks about the sacrifice of Jesus on the cross like this: "For then he would have had to suffer again and again since the foundation of the world, but as it is, he has appeared once for all at the end of the age to remove sin by sacrifice of himself." Hebrews chapter 9 verses 26. When Christ came into the world, he said, "Sacrifices and offerings you have not desired, but a body you have prepared for me." Hebrews chapter 10 verses 5. So what we talk about here is something called atonement. Why did Jesus die? Why was he crucified? What was the purpose? And how is it related to the sacrifices that were made by the priests in the Old Testament? So to understand that much more better, you need to understand the term atonement. Let's watch a small video in terms of that.
We all long for the world to be good, for people to live in peace, act with love and justice. But there's a problem. Something compels us humans to constantly wreak havoc and destruction instead, and we call this evil.
And from the Bible's point of view, evil ruins things in at least two ways. There's a direct effect of our evil, like when someone steals from another person, they've created injustice.
Yeah, therefore, you know, they owe something to make it right.
But there's another indirect effect of evil, because they've also ruined the environment of the relationship, creating a lack of trust, there's emotional damage. It's like vandalism, and they need to make that right, too.
Now, many people believe, hey, God is good, he should be the one to just get rid of all the evil in the world.
But let's be honest. I mean, the evil that I see everywhere out there, it's the same evil that's inside of me. We have all contributed, and we keep doing it.
And so this kind of puts us in a bind. If God's going to rid the world of evil, he'll have to get rid of us.
And this is what's so remarkable about the story of the Bible. This God is so good that not only is he going to rid the world of evil, he's going to do it without destroying humanity.
So how is he going to do that?
Well, early in the story of the Bible, we're introduced to this practice of animal sacrifice, which I know, it seems weird to us, but for the Israelites, it was a very powerful symbol of God's justice and of his grace. So remember, I'm a contributor to the evil that's in the world. I should be removed. But God is allowing this animal's life to be a substitute. It's symbolically dying in my place. And the biblical word for this is atonement, which means to cover over someone's debt. But there's a second part to this ritual. Remember, evil also causes this relational vandalism. And in the Bible, this idea is described as polluting or defiling the land and making it unclean. So the priest would symbolically wash away the vandalism by sprinkling the animal's blood in different parts of the temple.
So the animal's blood is cleaning things?
Well, remember, this is a symbol, and it's a symbol that we're not used to. The blood represents life. And the sprinkling of the blood is this representation of how God is cleaning away these indirect consequences of evil in their community. In the Bible, this process is called purification. And so the temple and the land now become a clean space where God and his people can live together in peace.
So this ritual makes things right between Israel and God.
And more than that, the Israelites experience God's love and his grace through these symbols. And by being forgiven, ideally, this would compel them to become people of love and grace too.
Right, that's the ideal, but it wasn't always happening.
Right. So the prophet Isaiah, for example, he talks a lot about this. He opens his book by saying that the continual sacrifices of the Israelites had become meaningless because they were also allowing great evil in their midst, ignoring the poor and the oppressed. Even the Israelite kings were distorting justice. But Isaiah looked forward to a day when a new king from the line of David would come and deal with evil, but in a surprising way. The king would become a servant, and not just serve, but also suffer and die for the evil committed by his own people. And his life would be offered as a sacrifice.
And this is the promise Jesus believed he was fulfilling. He's the king of Israel suffering and dying on the cross.
In fact, Jesus himself used Isaiah's words when he said that he came to serve and give his life as a ransom for many. And that word ransom refers to a sacrifice of atonement. And so all over the New Testament, we hear about how Jesus' death was an atoning sacrifice for us. It covered the debt that humans owe God for contributing to all of the evil and death in his world. But the New Testament authors also talk about Jesus' death as providing purification. And so we hear about Jesus' blood as a symbol of his life, having this ability to wash away the vandalism that evil has caused in us and around us, so we can now live at peace with God.
So that's the meaning behind Jesus' death. But there's more to the story.
Yeah, the New Testament makes this powerful claim that Jesus' death was not final. He rose from the dead. And so he's the sacrifice who broke the power of death and evil, which means that he lives on to offer his life to anyone who will accept it. He is the perfect sacrifice to which all the previous sacrifices were pointing all along.
So because of Jesus, the early Christians stopped participating in the ritual of animal sacrifice.
But they were given new rituals. There are two that Jesus taught his followers to perform. The first is called baptism. Just as Jesus died, so going into the water becomes this personal connection you now have to his death. And in coming out of the water, you, so to speak, come back to life with Jesus. So baptism is this sacred ritual that joins your story to Jesus' death and his resurrection. The second ritual is called the Lord's Supper, which is a reenactment of Jesus' last meal with his disciples, and he used bread and wine to portray his coming death as a sacrifice. And so now, followers of Jesus, they take the bread and the cup regularly to remember and to participate in the power of Jesus' death and in his life.
So these rituals, they remind us of God's love and encourage us to live a life of love and grace.
But they do more than that. They connect us to a new life source. The very power that brought Jesus back from the dead is the same power that can deal with the evil in our own lives and transform us into people who lead lives of love and peace.
I hope you really enjoyed the video and you got a good idea about what is atonement. Now, if you take a look at the priests in the Old Testament, as it is shown in the video, we can see how they offer sacrifices as a kind of replacement for their own sins that they have done. So it's sort of like removing your own sins by sacrificing the lamb. It denotes that. But this kept going on and on, and Israelites, they kept making their same mistakes again and again. So, you know, it's sort of like not a proper way to atone with God or repent with God. We are committing sins again and again, and as a way to resolve them, we are sacrificing the lamb. This is what was going on in the old priests. Then came along Jesus Christ, as we can see here. Jesus offered the sacrifice once for all our sins, as it's said in Hebrews chapter 10 verses 11 to 12. He came along, he said there is no more animal sacrifices required. He is going to be the only one who is going to sacrifice himself, his own life, so that we be freed of all our sins. Jesus, sent by the Father, fulfilled his mission by his own life of sacrifice. He proclaimed the eternal and great love of God through his sacrifice on the cross. The greatest proclamation of Jesus was his sacrifice on the cross. The greatest missionary activity of priestly life is to sacrifice one's own life. Jesus is the only priest. All the other priests share in his priesthood. Each Christian joins with the priesthood of Jesus through baptism and anointing. But God chooses some specifically or specially and appoints them for ministerial priesthood. Priests are those who receive such vocation. Now, one priesthood of Christ. Everything that the priests of the Old Covenant prefigured finds its fulfillment in Christ Jesus, the one mediator between God and men, as it is seen in the Catechism of the Catholic Church 1544. By a single offering, he has perfected for all those who were sanctified, that is by the unique sacrifice of the cross, again in CCC 1544. So as you can see how priesthood is one with Christ. He is the only priest, and the priests that we have now are his servants. Now, to understand the hierarchy of this, we need to take a look at what is the two kinds of priesthoods that are available. The redemptive sacrifice of Christ is unique, accomplished once for all, yet it is made present in the Eucharistic sacrifice of the Church. The same is true of the one priesthood of Christ. It is made present through the ministerial priesthood without diminishing the uniqueness of Christ's priesthood. Only Christ is the true priest, and the others being only his ministers. Hence the word ministerial priesthood. Now, what is that ministerial priesthood? Is it not just priesthood? So this is from CCC 1545, the Catechism of the Catholic Church. Now, there are actually two participations in one priesthood of Christ. We do not know that. This is new knowledge to us. So, in reality, as it is said in the previous CCC chapters that we saw, once you receive baptism and confirmation, you are actually called to priesthood. But there are some people who receive that extra special call to be a ministerial priesthood. So, as such, this one priesthood has two different categories, which is common priesthood and ministerial priesthood. So everybody, all the Christians who receive the sacraments of baptism and confirmation, which is us, we are the common priesthood. Okay? And those who receive the sacrament of the holy orders are called to be the ministerial priesthood. Now, how does this all come into picture? Every Christian is called to be a disciple of Christ. But the one who receives this call for ministerial priesthood ought to live this discipleship in a much deeper way. Jesus said, "You did not choose me, but I chose you." John chapter 15 verses 16. Priesthood is a mission to be fulfilled with full responsibility, offering oneself totally to God who called him. Each priest is bound to fulfill his mission with God, interests him through the offering of his life. The priest fulfills this duty mainly through the proclamation of the word, offering the holy mass and pastoring. Now, to understand this much better, you need to know the hierarchy of priesthood right from the apostles to the bishops to the priests and to the deacons. For that, we again look through the Catechism of the Catholic Church, which describes the status and duties of priesthood. Holy Orders is a sacrament through which the mission entrusted by Christ to his apostles continues to be exercised in the Church until the end of time. Thus is the sacrament of apostolic ministry in CCC 1536. So the priesthood is essentially segregated into three degrees. One is the episcopate, next is the presbyterate, and finally diaconate. Now, these might be complicated terms, but in simpler terms, we know them as bishops, priests, and deacons. So these are the three major classifications or degrees of order or holy orders under one priesthood. Okay, so remember again, one priesthood has two different categories depending on the sacraments you receive. Everybody who receives baptism and confirmation are called to be common priesthood, and those who receive the holy orders along with that are called for the ministerial priesthood. And this particular ministerial priesthood has three categories as shown here: bishops, priests, and deacons. Now, to understand how this actually works, let us take a look at a short animated video here.
Jesus founded the church. And this church has a hierarchical structure which is in the service of the whole mystical body. Jesus chose not 23 or 17, but 12 apostles, and he entrusted them with a special role. It was no coincidence that their number ended up being exactly 12, because just as in the Old Covenant there were the 12 tribes of Israel, so now in the New Covenant there were to be 12 new tribes, a new people of God from all peoples and nations of the earth. As the apostles went out into the world to spread the message of Jesus, the first Christian communities emerged. The apostles appointed suitable men as leaders, shepherds, and protectors of these communities. The Greek word for this office is episcopus, from which comes also our English word, bishop. The bishops are the successors of the apostles, consecrated to their office through the laying on of hands. Now, just as there was a special apostle among the apostles, namely Peter, so also is there a special bishop among the bishops today. This special bishop is the Bishop of Rome. He is special precisely because he is the successor of St. Peter. He is called the Pope. The Pope serves the church, like Peter did once in guiding her, guaranteeing her unity and taking care that the teaching of Christ is passed on faithfully just as it was received. The bishops are today exactly as they were in the beginning of Christendom, the shepherds of a particular Christian community. But because they can't be everywhere and serve everyone in their communities at once, they have co-workers, the priests. Priests are consecrated by their bishop to serve smaller communities within the larger community. Such a smaller unit is called a parish, and the priest in charge is called a pastor. Sometimes parishes get a second priest who supports the pastor. He is called the vicar, chaplain, or assistant priest. This is the basic hierarchical structure of the church, but, and this is important, the hierarchy in the church is not so much one of ruling and power, but according to the command of Christ, a hierarchy of service. The whole hierarchy ultimately stands at the service of all faithful, in ensuring that none of them ever lack the means necessary to progress on the way to God. In this way, the usual idea of hierarchy is turned upside down. Among the members of the mystical body, the Pope is, in the end, not the ruler, but the servant of all. The truest and most beautiful official title of the Pope is, therefore, Servus Servorum Dei, the servant of the servants of God.
I hope you enjoyed the animated video and understood a lot about how the hierarchy works, right from the Pope to the deacon. The fullness of ministerial priesthood is given to the bishops by Jesus through the apostles. Priests are the co-workers of bishops. They remain as representatives of Jesus, the shepherd, and the head of the church. They are called to be with Jesus to proclaim the word of God, to administer the sacraments, and to lead the people of God. The fundamental mission of priests is to constantly build up in the world, the church, the people of God, the mystical body of Christ, and the temple of the Holy Spirit. They are the mediators between God and men. They offer prayers of the people of God to God and help them to know the will of God. Now, this is mainly what are the duties and the status of priesthood. I think we will end the session here. This is part 1 of our lesson number 12, and in the next part we will take a look at what are his other duties of apostolic mission through the ministry of teaching, the ministry of sanctification, and the ministry of pastoral service. So with that, I'll end the session here. Thank you so much. I'll see you in the next class. Take care. Bye-bye.